in the NFL these days, it's not uncommon to see and hear on-field expressions of religious faith, gestures and moments that are magnified by the attention on these games and observed in tens of millions of homes. John Barr examines this trend, which began almost unnoticed 30 years ago.
Hallowed, holy be thy name. Forgive us our sins, Father.
In the solitude of a quiet sanctuary,
as we forgive those who sin against us,
Herb Lusk finds peace through daily prayer. But it was his display of faith before a crowd of nearly 50,000 that secured his place in NFL history.
As soon as I got there, I dropped down on my knee and prayed. I said, thank you, Jesus. And then I said to myself, it's about time.
What's become commonplace today, players praying after reaching the promised land of the end zone, had never happened before this October day at Giants Stadium in 1977. That's when Lusk, an unknown backup tailback on Dick Vermeil's Philadelphia Eagles, became the first NFL player to pray after scoring a touchdown.
He took a 48 toss out the backside of I formation to the left and went 70 yards for a touchdown with it. When he got down there, there was just himself and one guy chasing him.
I made that one move through that little slit, and it was a foot race after that. I just thought that expressing my faith publicly, regardless of what the people say, would make no difference. I'm going to publicly declare my relationship with God, and the end zone became my pulpit.
This was a sincere, spontaneous reaction of giving thanks for what he was just given the opportunity to do.
It wasn't about her bringing attention to himself. Hey, look at me, I scored a touchdown. He was demonstrating his faith.
I say to myself, that's why I played the NFL. That's why I played.
Prayer has long been a part of pro football, but before Herb Lusk, it was mostly reserved for the locker room.
Thank you, Father, Jesus, another opportunity. Show your glory.
In more recent years, all of that's changed.
Because the Lord said so, baby. Because the Lord said so.
Even after Super Bowl 41, Colts head coach Tony Dungy used football's greatest stage to deliver a faith-based message.
Lovie Smith and I, not only the first two African-Americans, but Christian coaches showing that you can win, doing it the Lord's way. We're more proud of that.
During the games themselves, a number of players, from Seahawks running back Sean Alexander to Colts wide receiver Reggie Wayne and Giants wide receiver Plaxico Burress, continue Herb Lusk's tradition.
Have you ever received any static from anybody about what you do on the field at any level?
No, the static that I get is you need to find your touchdown dance, or you know, you need to do some dance so you get more recognition. But you know, I don't believe that. I believe that, you know, I can go out and score touchdowns and get on one knee and say thank you because I expect myself to go out and score.
Post-game prayer circles, started in the mid-1980s by the late Hall of Famer Reggie White, are now commonplace. But in this era of outward faith in football, some take religious displays to another level.
Let's get that prayer. Let's get that prayer, baby. Let's get a prayer. Let's get a prayer, fellas.
I've always been, you know, an extremist. I'm one way or the other. And when I became a Christian, I was not shy at all about sharing my faith.
Father God, we just praise you that you are God and we are not. Lord, your word says we don't know your ways. Your ways are higher than our ways.
Detroit Lions quarterback Jon Kitna has easily emerged as the most vocal Christian player in the NFL.
Lord, I pray that you look down on this field, you see men that are committed to you. It's about Jesus Christ, baby. It ain't about me.
When he was with the Bengals in 2003, Kitna was fined $5,000 by the NFL for wearing a cap with a cross instead of league-approved apparel. The NFL later withdrew the fine, but Kitna still wears the cross whenever he's permitted under league rules.
A lot of times I'm praying. I'll be praying on my way up to the line of scrimmage that the Lord would just give me peace at that time. Just give me wisdom. Let me see things as you would see them. Let my arm throw the ball, you know, where I'm looking to throw the ball. And, you know, there's I'm praying a lot. You know, people wouldn't understand that or maybe don't know that, but throughout the game, we're praying.
I say the guy's out of his mind if he thinks he is spreading the gospel of Jesus on a football field.
Anthony Pryor played defensive back for 6 years in the NFL.
You don't glorify God on the football field. You glorify God what you do outside the football arena.
As athletes, our whole life, we've been praying to get to the NFL. So our prayers are answered.
In his recent book, The Slave Side of Sunday, Pryor questions the role of prayer in pro football and even says the majority of players who display their faiths are more interested in image than ideals.
It's safe because you can get away with more as a Christian. You know, you can personify yourself when you go into the locker room. Oh man, this guy's a strong Christian. He's a good guy. But you know, once you leave the locker room and leave the stadium, people don't know what you're doing, you know? So to have the title a Christian athlete, that's a safe thing. So they can sustain themselves to have a long career.
Nobody has questioned whether Jon Kitna genuinely believes. It's what he believes that has raised some eyebrows. After suffering a mild concussion in a Week 2 game against Minnesota, Kitna sat out most of the second half, but then came back to lead the Lions to an overtime win.
For me, it was a miracle, because a miracle to me is something that I can't explain and doctors can't explain, and that's what happened. And other people think it was other things, and that's fine. But for me and my faith, that was a miracle.
I did ask him after the game, you know, what was all that about, you know? He's like, man, I just felt God took over my body and was playing. And I'm like, huh? You know, what? It's just a weird take on the whole situation of out of 1,696 players, why Jon Kitna?
Why would God care about something as trivial as a football game?
Those are people who don't understand who God really is. And God is omnipresent, omnipotent, all-knowing, in control of all things God. He can be everywhere at one time and still be just as involved in a football game as he is in another part of the world.
In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
If both teams pray to God, both teams pray for victory. One team wins, another team loses, multiple injuries. What, God loved one team more than he loved the other?
Who you win, Jesus?
Does religion have any place in sport, in your opinion?
Absolutely not.
What harm does it do to have a guy pray or to point not to himself, but to God? What harm does it do for God to express his faith in a tasteful way? I don't think it does any harm. I think it, listen, it's only a moment.
When I got down, I fell down on my knee and prayed, never thinking that 30 years later, people would make a big deal out of it.
Back in Philadelphia, Herb Lusk, the praying tailback who started it all 30 years ago, has taken his passion for Jesus Christ to the pulpit. For the last 25 years, he's served as lead pastor at Greater Exodus Baptist Church.
Can I get a witness in this house?
What I'm doing right now, God, I'm going touchdowns every day.
Compared to today's displays of faith in football, what Lusk did seems downright discreet. But one simple moment secured his legacy.